Hello, this is Lazarus at telecomTech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining IPv4 subnetting in action. Please take a moment to subscribe to my channel and to like this video if you find it useful. In order to become proficient in subnetting, it's important to first understand why it's required and how it works from a network device's perspective. It's also important to learn about the network and broadcast addresses within each subnet. I have several videos addressing these topics, and you can find links to them in the description below. If you're new to subnetting, it's worth taking the time to view those videos before continuing here. Now, this video is going to be the first in a series of videos that will show how subnetting is achieved. In each video, we'll be looking at a different enterprise network scenario with a particular addressing scheme requirement, and we'll go through a step-by-step process to solve each particular case. For today's scenario, let's say that we are given an address space of 192.168.22.0/23. From this address space, we are asked to create multiple subnets of various sizes for an enterprise network. These subnets will have an expected number of hosts as shown here. We want one subnet with 35 hosts, another with 12, another with 72, another with 230, and another with 25. Now, these are the actual physical devices that the enterprise wants to connect into each subnet. Now, let's take a look at our original address space that we were given, which is 192.168.22.0/23. And let's take a look at this address range with the full subnet mask written out. And we can see that here. The subnet mask is 255.255.254.0. Now let's take a look at this again, but we'll represent the last two octets in binary. We can see that with this subnet mask, we reserve 23 bits for the network address, and it's the last 9 bits that are defined as the host addresses. How large is this full address space we're given? It's 2 to the power of 9, where 9 is the number of host bits, and that gives us a value of 512. Now, when we look at our subnets, the first thing to do is to list those subnets in order from largest to smallest, based on the required number of hosts. So here's our list again, but in decreasing order. This is an important step that will become evident as we go along. If we don't do this, our subnetting will not be successful. I've also labeled each subnet here so it will be easier to refer to them. Next, based on the required number of hosts per subnet, we must choose a subnet size. Remember, the sizes of our subnets are always 2 to the power of x, where x is the number of host bits. I've already gone in and chosen the most appropriate subnet size for each of the subnets that we've been given. That number in red is actually the number of host bits that we're going to use. So automatically, you know the number of network bits for each one. And thus, we can derive the subnet mask that we'll be using for each of those subnets. All right, so let's take a look at the details of subnet number one. We want to accommodate 230 hosts. We are using 8 host bits, and that gives us 256 addresses. With 8 host bits, that means that our subnet mask in binary is composed of 24 ones and 8 zeros, like so. In dotted decimal format, that comes to 255.255.255.0. Now, to start subnetting, we take our initial address space of 192.168.22.0, and we'll write it out with the last two octets in binary, like so. Then we put in our subnet mask for our first subnet, which is 255.255.255.0, and we'll also represent this with the last two octets in binary, like so. Now we draw a line at this point where the subnet mask tells us that the host and network portions are split. Our subnet mask says that the first 24 bits are the network portion and the last 8 are the host portion. Next, we start by writing out the network address of our subnet. Remember, this is the address that has all host bits set to 0. Next, we write out the first host address. This is simply the network host address plus one. Now, it would make sense next to look at the last host address, but that's not always easy. It's easier to determine the broadcast address first. Remember, the broadcast address has all the host bits set to one, and here's what it looks like. Finally, from that broadcast address, we can derive our last host address. This is easy to find because it's simply the broadcast address minus one. So now we found all of the important addresses in this process for our first subnet. We have the network address, the first and last host addresses, and the broadcast address. The only thing that's left to do is to write them out in dotted decimal format. And here they are. Now, one thing to notice is that the network address is actually exactly the same as the original address that we were given. However, it's not actually the same because our subnet mask is different. It's a smaller subnet mask, meaning that the resulting subnet is a subset of the original address space we were given. So that's the first subnet that we've created, and we have all of the information to do our addressing for that subnet. Let's continue on to the next four subnets. Here, we see again the size of our second subnet needs to accommodate 72 hosts, and we've decided to use a subnet mask that gives us 7 host bits for a total of 128 addresses. Looking at the subnet mask, we get 7 zeros at the end for the host portion, which translates to a subnet mask of 255.255.255.128. Now, previously, for the network address of our subnet, we used the network address of the address space we were given. What network address should we start with here? Well, we use the following rule. The network address of this subnet is the broadcast address of the previous subnet plus one. So we had as a broadcast address the 192.168.22.255 in the previous subnet. Adding one to that, we get 192.168.23.0. So this is our network address for subnet number two. Now, once again, we use our network address and our subnet mask, and we are representing the last two octets in binary. We draw our line to separate the host portion from the network portion based on that subnet mask. Then we get our network address by setting all 7 host bits to 0. And we get our first host address by adding 1 to that network address. Next, we determine our broadcast address by setting all host bits to 1. And finally, we get our last host address by subtracting 1 from our broadcast address. We now have all of our vital information to assign IP addresses to this subnet, and let's look at these addresses in dotted decimal format again, and we get these values we see. Let's go on to subnet number 3. Let's look at our parameters once again. Here we want to accommodate 35 hosts, so we're using 6 bits for the host portion that gives us up to 64 addresses. Now, just a note here, we couldn't use a smaller subnet mask of just 5 bits for the host addresses because those 5 bits would only give us 32 hosts, but we need to accommodate 35. So we necessarily must use the next size up, which is those 6 bits. So 6 bits for the host portion will give us 64 addresses. Now, looking at the subnet mask in binary, with 6 host bits, we get this, which in dotted decimal format is 255.255.255.192. And again, we get our network address from this particular subnet by looking at the broadcast address of the previous subnet plus 1. And that gives us an address of 192.168.23.128. Now we go through the same process again, and we use our network address and our subnet mask, and we're representing the last two octets in binary. We draw our line separating the host portion from the network portion based on that subnet mask, and we get our network address by setting all 6 host bits to 0. We then get our first host address by adding 1 to our network address. We determine our broadcast address by setting all host bits to 1. And finally, we get our last host address by subtracting 1 from our broadcast address. Again, we now have all of our vital information to assign IP addresses to this subnet. Let's look at these addresses again in dotted decimal format so we can know what we're actually going to assign to our hosts. Now, at this point, I'd like to remind you that repetition is key. If this is starting to get tedious, that's okay. That's part of the process. If you do several dozen of these subnetting exercises, you'll very quickly become proficient. So let's go on. We have 2 more subnets to go. Let's go on to subnet number 4. Let's look again at the parameters of this subnet. We want to accommodate 25 hosts, so using 5 bits in the host portion will give us up to 32 addresses. Now looking at the subnet mask in binary, with 5 host bits, we get this, which in dotted decimal format is 255.255.255.224. And again, we get our network address from this particular subnet by looking at the broadcast address of the previous subnet and adding 1 to that. And that turns out to be 192.168.23.192. Let's look at our network address and our subnet mask, representing them again with the last 2 octets in binary. And we draw our line separating the host portion from the network portion based on that subnet mask. We now get our network address by setting all 5 host bits to 0. And we get our first host address by adding 1 to our network address. Next, we determine our broadcast address again by setting all 5 host bits to 1. And finally, we get our last host address by subtracting 1 from our broadcast address. We now have all of the information we need to assign IP addresses to this subnet. Let's take a look at these addresses again in dotted decimal format. Let's go on now to our 5th and final subnet. Here are the parameters for this subnet. We want to accommodate 12 hosts, so we're going to be using 4 bits for the host portion, and that gives us up to 16 addresses. Looking at the subnet mask in binary, with 4 host bits, we get this, which in dotted decimal format is 255.255.255.240. And again, we get our network address for this particular subnet by looking at the broadcast address of the previous subnet plus 1, which turns out to be 192.168.23.224. Once again, we use our network address and our subnet mask, and we represent them with the last 2 octets in binary. Then we draw our line separating the host portion from the network portion based on that subnet mask. We then get our network address by setting all 4 host bits to 0. And we get our first host address by adding 1 to our network address. And then we determine our broadcast address by setting all host bits to 1. And finally, we get our last host address by subtracting 1 from our broadcast address. We now have all of our vital information to assign IP addresses to this 5th subnet. Let's take a look at these addresses in dotted decimal format, and we get these values. At this point, we're done. We found the network and broadcast address of each of our subnets. We know the first and last host addresses of each of our subnets, and we know the subnet mask of each of our subnets. Now, there's just one more thing I'd like to add here before I sign off. There are still some addresses that are left over. Our last broadcast address was 192.168.23.239. We still have addresses ranging from 192.168.23.240 all the way up to 255. And these are available to be subnetted in future subnets. Now, this was just the first in a series of videos that I'll be posting that will have several examples of how subnetting is performed. And each video will have different examples with various parameters every time. Subnetting is a huge topic, so look out for more of my videos covering the various aspects of this topic. I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. If you'd like me to address other related topics, feel free to let me know in the comments below. And please subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at Telecom Tech. I hope this has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.